So let's continue this morning session with another plenary talk. It's my great pleasure and honor to introduce the next plenary speaker, Janos Pach. Janos is a typical representative of the Hungarian School of Combinatorics. He has been associated with the Rényi Institute in Budapest, and now he also is head of the Laboratory of Combinatorial and Geometric Structures at the Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology. His main fields of interest are discrete and computational geometry, convexity, and combinatorics. He has written more than 300 research papers, notably more than 20 papers with Paul Edesh. He has written also several books, his research problems in discrete geometry and combinatorial geometry were translated into several languages. For his scientific achievements, he received several prizes, including the Lester R. Ford Award from the Mathematical Association of America, the Rényi Prize and the Academy Award from the Hungarian Academy of Sciences. He was elected an ACM Fellow, member of Academia Europaea, and AMS Fellow. And he was also an invited speaker on the International Congress of Mathematicians in Seoul in 2014. So let me now pass the virtual floor to Janos.
Thank you very much, Pavel, for the nice introduction. Now I will attempt to share my screen. Yes. I hope it's fine. You can see that. Can you see that?
Yes, it's perfect.
Yeah, well, it's not perfect for me because I cannot see.
It's okay. Okay.
I cannot see your face, Pavel, anyway, and I cannot see my face. So whenever I run out of the picture, please indicate it. it is needless to say that it's a tremendous honor to be here. It would be a tremendous pleasure to be in Portoros, but unfortunately it didn't happen because the lectures are virtual. So let me start. Look at this picture. This is a famous painting of Pere Borel del Caso from the second half of the 19th century. And what you see is a boy kind of holding the frame of the picture and climbing out of the canvas. And well, it looks like that he escapes the limitations and constraints of the two-dimensional plane and sets himself free to soar into the three-dimensional space. But actually we know that the picture is two-dimensional. But look at the face of the boy. Doesn't he look scared? I bet he is. And he has good reason to be scared, because when you glance at higher dimensions, then higher dimensional space is full of traps, full of curses, if you will, full of complications. And several people noticed that. Perhaps the first one who noticed that was Ronald Fisher, whose name you don't hear nowadays too much, because he was the first head of the UCL eugenics department. Although definitely he was not a racist, he was one of the founding fathers of statistics. And he knew that at the Rudolstadt experimental station of crops research, there had been a tremendous amount of data accumulated over 50 years, including data about crops, but also data about flowers, like as this famous iris data set. So he decided to go to work on this data rather than continue in academia. And soon after he noticed that, he realized the curses of high dimension, that one of the main problems turned out to be, surprisingly, that there was too much data. You know, even if you look at an iris, this flower, then you make some measurements. There were too many measurements, and this means that these measurements correspond to a point in a very high dimensional space. So that was a problem, and he decided, among other things, to use this data for the taxonomy of irises. Now, the expression itself, the curse of dimensionality, this expression was raised by or coined by Richard Bellman, another great applied mathematician, who also thought that doing research close to reality is very important. And he formulated this thing, the name curse of dimensionality comes from the fact that if we go to higher dimensions, especially when the distribution of the data is rather uniform, then we have to take an awfully large sample in order to draw any conclusions. Now, this kind of phenomenon, combinatorial, is also called the combinatorial explosion. But if there are curses that come with the high dimensions, and there must be blessings that come with the low dimensions. And in fact, what I'd like to do in this talk, that I'd like to explain four basic combinatorial problems. And in each of these problems, if you restrict the dimension, then the problem becomes kind of tractable. The question is, of course, what the dimension means. And in each case, there will be a technical definition. In some cases, it will be the Euclidean dimension. In some cases, the Dushnik-Miller dimension or the Wapnick-Chervonenkis dimension. It doesn't matter. In each case, I will describe what the important factor is. So let's jump into the deep water. Well, actually, it's not too deep water. The first problem that I'd like to discuss is independence numbers, about independence numbers of graphs, one of the most basic and oldest notions about graphs. So here you see this purple graph, one of examples, and the independence number of the graph is defined as the largest number of vertices that you can pick. In this case, it seems that these four vertices, so that no two of them are connected by an edge. It was realized at an early stage, Karp 1972, that to determine the independence number of a graph is a hopelessly difficult task. In fact, it was included in this famous monography of Gary and Johnson of a list of MP complete problems. And this is one of the basic problems. So moreover, it's not only difficult to determine the independence number, but it turned out that it's also difficult to estimate the independence number with a within a multiplicative factor. Of course, within a multiplicative factor of n, you can estimate it, because the independence number is a number which is between 1 and n. So if they ask you that what is the independence number, you say that my guess is 1. Then this is, since the independence number is at most n, this is definitely within n of the truth. But assume that you want a little bit better. You fix a small epsilon like 0.01, and you want to estimate the independence number of the graph within a factor of n to the 0.99, but n is the number of vertices. As usual in computer science, you want to do it in polynomial time. It turns out it's impossible, unless P is equal to MP, that not too many people believe. Now, I'd like to show that for certain classes of graphs, actually, you can do better. So let me define the string graphs. So it's very easy notion. So what are strings, first of all? Strings are these little green worms, continuous curves in the plane. So here you see five strings. To each of them, you assign a vertex, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And two vertices you connect by an edge if and only if the corresponding arcs, corresponding strings intersect. So 1 and 2 intersect, so 1 and 2 are connected by an edge. 1 and 5 are not connected by an edge. Indeed, the first string and the fifth string, they are disjoint. So this the string graph describes the intersection pattern of these strings. The notion wasn't introduced by mathematicians, but by scientists. So the first one was probably Seymour Benzer, a famous molecular biologist and geneticist, for whom these strings meant segments in chromosomes. And he asked the right mathematical questions already about them, and computational questions. The another person who a few years later studied this subject was Frank Sinden at Bell Laboratories in New Jersey. And for him, this was a description, the string graphs were a description of kind of printed circuits, printed layers in printed circuit. At that time, it was called VLSI design, today chip design. And also it played a role in the work of John O'Keefe, who got the Nobel Prize in, he was a neurologist in a few years ago, he got the Nobel Prize for his research for him. They were like dendrites of a neuron. Okay, so these are string graphs. And if we want to compute the independence numbers of string graphs, let's just for this presentation talk about k-intersecting string graphs. So the strings, there is a number k, like 10, and we consider only strings so that any two strings intersect in at most 10 points. These two intersect in 3 points. And I look at the intersecting, at the key intersecting string graphs, and it turns out that one can approximate the independence number of key intersecting string graph up to a factor of n to the epsilon. And you can choose your favorite small epsilon, like epsilon is 0.01 as before. You can approximate it in polynomial time up to a multiplicative factor of n to the 0.01. In fact, if you don't want to approximate, but you want to compute it, that it's also possible. It's possible in 2 to the n to the 4 fifths time, as I proved it with Jacob Fox. Now it looks like a huge number, this 2 to the n to the 4 fifths. But if you think about it, an n element vertex set has 2 to the n possible subsets. So the brute force algorithm would be that you check each of these subsets, whether they are independent sets, and that would take 2 to the n steps. And this is definitely much faster than that. Okay, so what makes this improvement possible? What is the blessing that comes with this considering strings in the plane? The blessing is that in the plane, we have separator theorems. So the general idea is that if you want to solve a problem like determine the independence number of a graph, then a good approach, which was suggested by Lipton and Tarjan and many others, is the divide and conquer approach. We try to cut our graph into two roughly equal halves. For each of those halves, we solve the problem separately and somehow combine the results. So therefore, these separator theorems are extremely useful. So this is about planar graphs, graphs whose edges don't cross each other. So here is one of the simplest planar graphs, you know, the grid, square root n by square root n grid. It has n grid vertices. And if you look at any vertex which is inside, then it has four neighbors, one to the north, one to the east, and so on. So if you look at this graph, you notice that if you delete the middle layer, the square root and vertices in the middle that I encircled with red, then it will fall into two roughly equal halves. And there are no edges running between these two parts. This is what I call a separator. So if I can separate this graph into two roughly equal halves. Now, we usually say that the parts are roughly equal if both of them contains at least one third of the vertices. It doesn't matter really. You just have sort of influences the constants. So what Lipton and Tarjan noticed that this is not just a property of the grid, but actually the same theorem is true for every planar graph of n vertices. And what we need for string graphs is a generalization of it to string graphs. Here you see many authors because the proof came sort of gradually in many steps. The strongest result, as I stated here, was proved by Lee. So the result sounds pretty much the same. We have a string graph, and by the deletion of few vertices, we want to divide it into two roughly equal halves so that there are no edges between them. But there is something interesting here. Here, the removal, what we have to remove, previously it was we have to remove square root of n vertices. Now we have to remove not square root of n vertices, but square root of e, where e is the number of edges. Of course, in this case, it doesn't matter because the number of edges is also linear. So these are the same. But in the case of a string graph, e can be much, much larger. So we can also formulate it for the strings themselves. So if you have a bunch of strings in the plane, and among them, there are E pairs that intersect, then you can delete square root of E of those strings so that the remaining strings fall into a left part and the right part, so to speak, so that there is no string in the left part which would intersect a string in the right part. Surprisingly, the proof of this result is far more complex than the proof of the Lipton-Tarjan separator theorem. And the simplest proof at the moment uses the theory of multi-commodity flows, also Burgen's theorem for metrical deformations, and also some combinatorial statements for the crossing number of a complete graph. A subject that Bojan Mohar will talk about in his public lecture later today. Okay, so now let's switch to the second problem, the second variant of irises represented, beautiful picture. So this is about another classical problem, the relationship between the chromatic number and the clique number of a graph. So what is the chromatic number of a graph? Just like in the four-color theorem, very simple definition. We want to color the vertices of the graph with as few colors as possible, so that two vertices that are connected by an edge always get different colors. And there's another important notion, the clique number of the graph, that how many vertices you can choose so that any two of them are connected by an edge. So this clique number is like exactly the opposite, which the complement of the independence number. Now we want to have many vertices that are pairwise connected. Of course, the chromatic number is always at least as large as the clique number, because if you have omega vertices so that any two of them are connected, then each of those omega vertices must get a different color in a good color. But it was realized at an early stage of graph theory that usually the chromatic number is much larger than the clique number. In fact, the first example, I think, first published example is due to Tutt from 1947, but it was followed by a whole series of examples of where we have triangle-free graphs. This means that omega is 2, there is no clique of size 3, but their chromatic numbers are arbitrary. The most interesting strengthening of that is perhaps the strengthening by Erdős from 1959, which is a famous one because this was one of the triumphs of the probabilistic method, which was introduced and mastered by Erdős, that not only that we have graphs of arbitrary large chromatic number that do not contain a triangle, a cycle of length 3. But there are graphs of arbitrary large chromatic number who do not contain any short cycle, any cycle shorter than 1,000. So locally, if you look at these graphs, then locally they look like trees, which are of course two colorable. Nevertheless, their chromatic number can be very, very large. That's a very counterintuitive result, and the effective constructions are much more complicated. Lovász came up with one, and there was also one, a famous one by Neschetfili and Drödl, using the amalgamation method, and so on. Now, at an early stage of graph theory, nevertheless, a lot of attention was given to classes of graphs for which equality holds. The chromatic number is equal to the clique number, and this is true in a hereditary way. So these graphs are called perfect graphs. And well, of course, most graphs are not perfect, but it's an interesting question to decide that how much not perfect they are, that how far they are from being perfect. And there was a very useful definition which was introduced by Gyárfás, or Gyárfás and Lehel perhaps, although it came up not with this exact definition, but the phenomenon itself in work of Asprund and Grünbaum much earlier. So we say that a class of graph is chi-bounded, nearly perfect. If OK, the chromatic number is not the click number. So it's not that it was the click number, but at least can be bounded from above by a function of the click number. So for the previous examples, this is not the case because we know that the click number is 2 and still chi of g is not bounded from above by any function of the of this 2. But it turned out that for many naturally defined quote unquote classes of graphs, this is true, that they are chi-bounded. And now here I have a kind of a menu. You don't have to read it just to give you a feeling that there are many such classes. So the first one was the Asplund-Grundmann for intersection graphs of rectangles. So they are chi-bounded. So what does it mean? It means that I look at rectangles in the plane, axis parallel rectangles, each of them, to each of them I assign a vertex. Two vertices are I connect if the rectangles intersect, just like in the case of string graphs. And it turns out that the chromatic number of these graphs can be bounded from above by, if I remember well, 8 times omega squared, a quadratic function. Since then, very recently, there was a big breakthrough by Davis who proved that this omega squared can be proved to omega log omega. Also, similar result is true for intersection graphs of balls in any dimensional spaces. And if I look at, instead of intersection graphs, I look at disjointness graphs. So if I have my geometric objects like segments, again, each of them, to each of them I assign a vertex, and now two of them I connect if they are disjoint, not if they intersect. So these are complements of intersection graphs, or disjointness graphs, or disjointness graphs of segments. They are also chi-bounded. And there are a number of similarly defined classes of graphs that strangely, you know, the definition is very similar, and yet they are not chi-bounded. For instance, if instead of considering intersection graphs of rectangles in the plane, I consider intersection graphs of boxes, axis parallel boxes in a three-dimensional space, they are not chi-bounded. Or if I look at intersection graphs of segments in the plane, most surprisingly, it turned out 7 years ago that they are not chi-bounded. No one believed that. And if I look at, instead of disjointness graphs of segments, I look at disjointness graphs of strings, any kind of curves, not straight line segments, then they are also not chi-bounded. So that here I just repeat this result that they are not chi-bounded. However, if I change the problem a little bit and I restrict my attention to strings that are X monotone. What does it mean that they are X monotone? It means that every string every string is intersected by any vertical line only in at most one point. So I can only consider strings like that are like graphs of a function or something like that. For X monotone strings, actually, there is a positive result. They are chi-bounded. They are nearly perfect, if you wish. If I look at disjointness graphs of X monotone curves, then their chromatic number can be bounded from above by the fourth power of the click number. What is the reason for that? I will say a couple of words about it in a second. But essentially, this is related to the fact that the disjointness structure of X monotone curves can be described by four partial orders. It looked like just an artifact of the proof, you know, that we needed four partial orders, not three. So it was widely believed that, in fact, this result can be improved. But in general, we are happy if we can prove any bound for the chromatic number or in terms of the click number. So it very rarely happens that we have a bond which is tight. Now, this is one of those rare cases. Last year, together with István Tomon, we managed to prove that actually the chromatic number of disjointness graphs of X monoton curves, we cannot have any better upper bound than omega to the four, and even the constant, maybe one can deter. It looks great, but before I continue my comments, I should say that it is partially a lie, because the most interesting special case of X-monoton curves are segments. And if I look at disjointness graphs of segments, then it is perfectly possible that this bounding function, omega to the four, can be replaced like by omega square. We don't know. The best lower bound is around omega to the 1.5, and is due to Jankic. Okay, so what is the blessing that makes this improvement in this special case possible? The blessing, as I already indicated, is that we can use partial orders here. So what? Let's look at the partial order. We know that a partially ordered set can always be sort of extended to a linear order. So we can make a drawing in which if a vertex is smaller in the partial order than another vertex, then it is lower than that. And then I connect them by an edge. And what we get is called the comparability graph of the partial order. So because of the transitivity, if we know that AB is an edge of the comparability graph, this means that A is smaller than B, and the BC is an edge of the comparability graph, B is smaller than C, then of course AC is also an edge of the comparability graph because A must be smaller than C. Similarly, if B is smaller than C, C is smaller than D, then B is smaller than D, therefore BD should also be an edge of the comparability graph. And comparability graphs are famously perfect graphs. The life is very nice for them. Now let's just change the definition a little bit. Instead of requiring that if A, B, B, C, C, D are edges of the graph, then both AC and BD are edges, I require that at least one of them is an edge. Then what we get is we call it a semi-comparability graph. And it turns out that semi-comparability graph, although they are not perfect, but they are chi-bounded, and in fact, we can determine the best bounding function, omega plus one choose two. So if a semi-comparability graph has click number omega, its chromatic number can be bounded from above by omega plus one choose two. This bound cannot be improved. Now, what is the relationship of X monoton strings with this semi-comparability graphs? Well, the most interesting case, and this is the heart of the matter, if instead of X strings, I just consider, X monoton strings, I just consider X monoton strings curves that all start on the y-axis. And then of course it can be naturally ordered according to their left hand points. If I look at the disjointness graphs of these curves, here I show four curves A, B, C, D, then they form a semi-comparability graph. So what does it mean? If AB, BC, CD are edges of that, this means that A is disjoint from B, B is disjoint from C, C is disjoint from B. Then I claim that at least one of these two things will happen. Either A and C are disjoint or B and D are disjoint. Assume that A and C are not disjoint. They intersect like here. But then this poor B that cannot intersect A and cannot intersect C, there is no way for it to get out of this triangle enclosed by A and C. So there's no way for it to intersect D. Therefore, BD will be an edge of the disjointness graph. So then we simply apply to the disjointness graph of these so-called grounded X monotone curves the result about semi-comparability graphs. And we get that for these disjointness graph of such X monotone curves, actually, the bounding function is omega plus one choose two. And then from that, after some technical steps, we get the original theorem. Okay, so let's go further. This is the third kind of iris. And now we don't need to give a new definition because this is about the relationship between clique number, independence number. We define both of them. Alpha is the independence number, how many pairwise independent vertices we can choose. The opposite of it is the clique number, how many vertices we can choose so that any two of them are connected. Okay. So, one of the best known theorems of combinatorics is Ramsey's theorem, which has applications in all parts of mathematics, in algebra, but also philosophically, it is a very interesting theorem, just like shown by the fact that Ramsey was basically a philosopher and an economist and all kinds of things. Okay. So what does it say? What did Ramsey notice? What Ramsey noticed in 1930 or 1931 was the following, that if I take a graph with n vertices, then it always contains either a large clique or a large independent set. Of course, we cannot tell which one because it doesn't necessarily contain a large clique because maybe there are no edges in the graph at all. We cannot tell if it always contains a large independent set because maybe the whole graph is that clique. But one of the two will happen. Of course, the details, the sort of devil is in the details, so to speak. So the question is that what is large? And this is why Erdős and Szekeres's names are here. Erdős and Szekeres from one direction and later Erdős from the other direction prove that actually the best function, the best size that we can guarantee of a clique of, or an independent set is roughly log n. This is one of the biggest questions in combinatorics is, of course, unsolved questions, where the truth lies between 1/2 log n and 2 log n. And in fact, since the results of Erdős and Szekeres, we didn't get much closer to an answer. Now, here I'd like to mention that this is really a natural theorem, so to speak, which is illustrated by the fact that it was also discovered by non-mathematicians, Sándor Szalai, well-known Hungarian sociologist, rediscovered the theorem and also proved it in some special cases. But already in the 1960s, early 1970s, Erdős, Radu, and Hajnal, who worked not only on independent Ramsey type or infinite Ramsey type questions, but also finite ones, suspected that although Ramsey's theorem, this log n in general, cannot be improved, but it can be improved for large classes of graphs. So, what are these large classes of graphs? Well, this is what is today called the Erdős-Hajnal conjecture. I will describe it in a second, but first I show this picture of not very good quality, but it shows Erdős and Hajnal standing next to each other in 1959. In front of them, Alfred Rényi is squatting. behind him, his wife was a strong mathematician, Catherine Reni, and this is Sándor Szalai, the sociologist I mentioned. So to state the Erdős-Hajnal conjecture, I have to introduce a very natural definition, that the graph, Venn is a graph property hereditary. It is called hereditary if whenever the property, a graph has its property, then every induced subgraph of it also has this property. So most of these natural graph properties we consider belong to this category. So for instance, if you look at a planar graph, you have an induced subgraph of it, it is also planar. Or if you have a graph that doesn't contain a cycle of length 5, you look at an induced subgraph of it, it also won't contain a cycle of length 5. Or string graphs, as a matter of fact, since we mentioned that already. If a graph can be represented as the intersection graph of strings in the plane, then any new subgraph of it has the same property. So what the Erdős and Hajnal conjecture is, was published only in 1989, but goes back much earlier, was that if I consider all graphs with a hereditary property, then there is a constant which depends on this hereditary property P, a positive constant, such that every graph with n vertices that has property P will contain a clique or an independent set of size not log n, n to the c, which is much, much bigger. At this point, I should say that it is called the Erdős-Hajnal conjecture, but in fact, neither of them conjectured or was sure that this is true. And we still don't know. But this is a basic question to decide. In fact, Erdős and Hajnal proved already in 1989 in the same paper that the phenomenon exists for hereditary graph properties much better Ramsey theorem is true. They didn't prove this n to the constant, which is e to the log n, but they proved that they contain a clique or an independent set of size e to the square root of log n, which is much better. And since I mentioned these special cases, I should also mention that within the last year, there were two serious breakthroughs. One of them was by Chudnovsky, Scott Seymour, and Spirkle, who actually proved that for the class of graph not containing a cycle of length 5 as an induced subgraph, the Erdős-Hajnal conjecture is true. And the other big breakthrough was by István Tomon, who proved that it is also true for string graphs. Okay, so I'd like to mention another very important general special case for which the Erdős-Hajnal conjecture is true. This is for semi-algebraic graphs, but for this I need to define semi-algebraic graphs. I could actually say it with one sentence, that semi-algebraic graphs are graphs that where the relationship that the two vertices are connected can be described by a small number of polynomial equations and inequalities of small degree at most d. Let me quickly go through a slightly more formal definition. I apologize for that. You can just, close your ears. So for this first, we have to define what a semi-algebraic set is. So semi-algebraic set, we take a Euclidean space. And in the Euclidean space, the locus of those points that can be determined by a small number of inequalities or equations, that's a semi-algebraic set of complexity at most D if there are the maximum of these parameters is D. So for instance, if you take a ball in three dimensions, it's a semi-algebraic set because you can describe the ball as the set of points for which x squared plus y squared plus z squared is at most one. That's a quadratic inequality. Or if I am in the d-dimensional space, I consider all polytopes that have a bounded number of facets, convex polytopes, or not convex polytopes, they are also form a semi-algebraic set. Okay, so once I know what a semi-algebraic set is, here you see a semi-algebraic set, this yellow bone, actually in 2D dimensions, because this picture is 2D dimensional. We have D dimensions here and D dimensions perpendicular to that. So when is a graph semi-algebraic? It is semi-algebraic if to each vertex of the graph, I can assign a point in the D-dimensional space, to U, a point PU, and then the vertex V, a point PV, let's draw the corresponding point in the other copy of the D-dimensional space, so that if I look at the point PU, PV in the 2D-dimensional space, then it falls into that yellow bone, into that nice semi-algebraic set, if and only if U and V are connected by an edge. So if my graph has such a description, then it is a semi-algebraic graph of complexity at most. Okay, so I apologize for that. I just want to mention that most of the geometrically defined natural sort of graphs fall into this category. Intersection graphs of segments, intersection graphs of balls, because for all of them, with polynomial equations and inequalities, you can describe the situation. Or a unit distance graph in the d-dimensional space, two points are connected if the distance is one, and so on. Now, the theorem I wanted to state here is the following, that if I fix a number d, then any semi-algebraic graph of complexity at most D has a clique or an independent number of size, at least n to the constant. But this constant is a positive constant depending on D. More precisely, it means that for semi-algebraic graphs of bounded complexity, the Erdős-Hajnal conjecture is true. So what is the blessing that makes it possible? The blessing that makes it possible, again, is a nice property of the d-dimensional space. So what it says is, and this was discovered by Schazel and Friedman, some special cases by Matušek, is that if I have a bunch of surfaces in the d-dimensional space, then I can cut the d-dimensional space into a small number of nice pieces so that each piece is intersected, crossed by roughly the same number of surfaces. So let me be a little bit more specific here, and I stated for straight lines. So my surfaces are these straight lines in the plane, these blue things, and I fix them n such straight lines, and I also fix a number r. Then I can divide the plane into R square rectangles. Well, here they are squares, but they are not necessarily squares, so that each of these squares is crossed by at most n divided by R lines. And that n divided by R is best. Now, I should say that there is a sort of competing combinatorial notion, the Babtik-Chervonenkis dimension of a set system, which was introduced by two Soviet mathematicians, the founders of statistical learning theory. And the definition is quite simple. So I look at a set system, an underlying set V, so the sets of the set system or hypergraph are E1, E2, and so on. And I take a set A of the ground set V, which doesn't necessarily belong to my set. And I say that this set A is shattered if for each of the subsets of A, and if A has k elements, there are 2 to the k such subsets, I can find a set in my set system which carves out precisely this subset from A. Then I call this subset shattered. And the Babtik Chabranek is that dimension of a set system is simply the size of the largest shattered subset of the underlying set. This notion plays a role in learning shapes. That's why learning theory, it was discovered in the framework of learning theory, but it is also very useful in computational geometry because many of the hypergraph set systems defined in geometric ways have this property that their Babtik Chabranek is dimensionless bounded. In particular, the semi-algebraic hypergraphs, the Babtik Chabranek is dimensionless are also bounded. Now, what is the blessing? What is the nice property that comes together with this Babtik Chabranek is dimension? Well, if you look at an n-element set, in principle, it can have 2 to the n subset. Out of the 2 to the n subsets, if you know that the Babtik Chabranek is dimension of the set system is at most d, then you have much, much fewer subsets in your set system. How much? At most n to the d. There is an exact formula which is here, but the important thing is that it's polynomial n to the d, provided that d is a bounded number. And the nice thing is that geometric picture that I said before can be generalized to this combinatorial case, and we can explore the geometric intuition behind to prove nice geometric theorems for set systems of bounded dimension. But now I come to my last problem, and there is another slide I'd like to show you. Here I don't show you an iris, I show you a sunflower. So I look at the set system again. In this case, it is K-uniform set system, K-uniform hypergraph. This means that each set has K elements. And I take some of these sets and I say that R sets, that they form an R sunflower if the intersection of any 2 of these sets is the same. So these sets in an R sunflower, E1 and E2, I call petals. And if I take 2 petals, then their intersection is what the disk of the sunflower is. And it is the same for any 2 petals. And there is somehow the sunflowers play an important role in circuit complexity and fast multiplication, matrix multiplication, and so on. So the big question is, and that was the Erdős-Radó discovery, that if you have sufficiently many K element sets, then you necessarily find an R sunflower. And it's interesting already if R is equal to 3. How big is it? How many sets do you need? Well, they could prove K factorial, but what they really conjectured was that an exponential, if R is equal to 3, then 2 to the k, an exponential number of sets is sufficient. There was nothing new for 60 years, and last year suddenly Alves, Lovett, Wu, and Zhang achieved a breakthrough by proving that, improving the bound. They didn't manage to prove the Erdős-Radó conjecture, but they managed to improve this k log k, the log k to log log k, which is a big achievement. And but they really hope that the truth is totally. And what the result that I'd like to close with is that actually the sunflower conjecture can be proved or almost proved in the case if we restrict our attention to set systems of VC dimension one, then we can prove it. And if the VC dimension is a bigger D, then instead of the log log K, we can get log star K, which is much better than log 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 log, and so on, an iterated logarithm function. Okay, so this is a good point to stop at with this beautiful picture of not an iris, but an other kind of flower, which I don't think is a sunflower, but it is beautiful. So if you stayed with me for all this time, then I thank you very much for your attention.